Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our NCERT based classes. So as you know that these classes are basically based on the NCERT books, which are the most fundamental books for your preparation, for the preparation of civil services examination conducted by the UPSC. Right? These books are also very basic books for other government competitive examinations also. Now we have brought these lectures basically for you who are preparing for these examinations, and you can basically refer those books also, NCERT based books, right? And you can subscribe of our channel on the YouTube also for those classes which are based on the NCERT books. These classes are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis. Okay, so you can revise or you can start your preparation with the help of these lectures which are uploaded on the YouTube. Alright, so they are very useful for your preparation. Alright, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so what we are going to start is basically the concept called power sharing. As you know, the power sharing is basically a concept where the power is divided among different constituents or different constituent units. The constituent units may be the central government, state government, or the local government. The constituent units may be a particular type of society, may be different religious groups, may be different communal groups, different caste groups. So all such division of the power based on certain predefined criteria is known as power sharing. Now, this power sharing is very important in order to reduce the conflict between the social groups, because the social groups basically are generally in the conflict because of this power sharing, right? The phenomena called power sharing. So definitely what happens is, the social conflict often lead to different type of violence, the instability in the political system, right? So what happens is, this power sharing is the best way you can harmonize those relationship, right? You can stabilize your political system, you can stabilize your political order, right? So what happens is, in the democratic system where the rule is basically by the people, right? This involves basically the power sharing. This is the most basic fundamental aspect, isn't it? And that will be to, in order to exercise your rights properly, you need to divide those powers. And in that power sharing, in any democratic setup, right, the government should be consulted, or government should consulting with those people who are going to govern, who are going to be governed. So that is the most fundamental thing, that the people should be consulted before forming any policy. So that is, if you are sensitive enough, right, how would you sensitive enough? If you give the more powers, or if you give the equal powers in the hand of those people who are interested in forming the government, right? So that is, the power sharing would definitely help in that process also. So that, in the basis of the principles of the democracy, the people are basically at the source of power. The people which are the ultimate source of power, isn't it? And power is basically shared, right, among the different organs of the government. The organs of the government, basically you have three: the executive part, right, which execute the policy; the legislative part, the legislature basically which enact the legislation in the parliament; and the judiciary, which basically interpret those laws which are made by the parliament, and they also enforce the rule of law in the country. Okay, and you can also have, the power should be also divided among the different governments that you have seen at the different levels, right? That level may be at the center level, at the top level, at the apex level, or between your states also, right, as well as with your local authorities also. Like you have the Panchayati Raj system or the local urban level self-governing structures. So that power division is also based on that premises. Okay, now whether this power sharing is desirable or not, this is the most important question. Now you can obviously conclude that the power sharing is most desirable because it gives you the most harmonistic relationship between the different constituent units. It will give the way to resolve all conflicts, right? It will give you the most probable way of establishing the most stable political order in the society, right? So it is good because it will reduce the conflict between the different social groups in the society, right? This is the most important thing. And obviously the power sharing is the most cardinal principles in any democracy, right? So power sharing is a very spirit of democracy. Without power sharing, a democracy cannot be called a democracy. You cannot implement the principles of the democracy without adopting the principles of power sharing. So the democratic rule basically involves the sharing of those affected by the exercise. So definitely you have to involve those people which are affected by the execution of those, you know, those powers that you are going to impact, that are going to execute. So those whose lives are affected, you have to take care. You have to take those people on the board in the power distribution equation. Then only the real democracy can be established at the grassroots level. Okay. And obviously, you know, the power, but the power sharing definitely bring you the most better outcomes, right? It will give you the most stability in the political order. It will give you the best harmonized system in the society. It will reduce all conflicts which are there. So what are the different forms of the power sharing? As you know that there are different forms of the power sharing between the different constituent units. So different power sharing formulas have been developed. Right. But you must understand the power sharing can be, you can say that one type of government may be a unitary government or unitary system where all power is basically centered with one center, isn't it? And in the democratic system or in the federal system, the power is basically divided between the different constituent unit. That means you have to divide those power. You have to divide those power. So power sharing is basically the source of, right, of all political power in the country. Right. So that means you have to respect, right, to the different diverse group that are existed in the society, and you should divide those power among them. Right. And everyone should have the voice in shaping the public politics or shaping the public policies which are affected by those policy. These are the, some of the cardinal principles regarding to the democracy. Right. So you can say that. The democracy, in any democracy, the political power should be distributed among the citizens, right, which maybe belongs to the different, you know, different political, you know, sections or different, you know, the social groups. Now let us take some of the most common arrangement that we have come across in the different, you know, system. So first of all, there is two types of the division of the power. The first is vertical division of the power. Second is horizontal division of the power. Right. So first we let us look the horizontal division of the power. What is that horizontal division of the power? So that you have seen that, as I told you, that the power is divided between the different organs of the government. Right. If you see, this is the government, and you have executive, you have basically your judiciary, and then you have your legislature. Now, in order to make independent to each other, and in order to make them that the different organs place at the same level to exercise different types of power, right, we call this type of division of the power is called horizontal division of the power. And the best example is the division of the power belongs to the government among the different organs of the government, that is executive, judiciary and legislature. Such type of division of power is basically known as the horizontal division of power. Now, as you have seen that, for example, there are different tiers of the government, right? First of all, you have the central government, okay, at the top level. Then you have the state governments, various states are there. Then you have the local government, isn't it? So you have this type of vertical, you know, the strata, vertical type of the division of the power between the central government, state government and local government. Such type of division of the power at a particular level is known as the vertical division of power. The vertical division of the power. That means you have the labels of the government. That is the highest label, state label, local label. So you have different labels of the government. The division of the power, right, between the higher and the lower levels of the government is known as vertical division of the power. I hope it is clear, right? Okay. And that apart from your horizontal division of the power, your vertical division of the power can be shared among different social groups. Right, different religious groups, different linguistic groups, that we will see in terms of our case studies, that how these powers have been divided among different religious groups, different linguistic groups and different social groups. We will look at that type of arrangement in subsequent study or case study that we have taken. I will take you. Okay, so power sharing is basically a best way to resolve all political conflicts. So here, you know, different type of, you know, the political movement which are give way, right, which is the best way to resolve all sort of a conflict that are basically existed in the society. Now let us understand some of the terms. First of all, ethnic. Ethnic means you say that the particular section of the society belongs to a particular ethnic origin. Ethnic origin means the particular section of the society. a particular section of the society. Now, this section of the society does not limited to the particular region, particular nation that may encompass, you know, in the different territories of the different countries. That means a ethnic group may be residing in a more than one countries, right? It is not necessarily a particular ethnic group should be entirely residing in a one particular nation. No, it can be cutting across different religion or different nationality, right? So that is, they share a particular, you know, a culture, a particular common descent, right? If they share a particular descent, particular common descent from their ancestors have been derived, a particular culture, right? That particular group of the people is known as a particular ethnic group, right? They need not to have within a particular religion or within a particular territory. No, they can be cutting across different religions, different territories, different nationalities across the space. Okay, what is majoritarian? Majoritarianism? The majoritarian is basically a political concept, which means it is a belief system that, for example, in India, let's say 83% of the people belongs to Hinduism. Let's say I'm just giving you an example, right? So let's say if the India should be governed based on the 83% Hindus, what they believe, okay? Or it should be governed based on all, you know, all major religious groups. So whether it should be a shared or it should be based on the entirely majority community. So if that type of governing system, which is based on the majority community, right, if the rule is based on the majority community, their wishes, their needs, right, that is called majoritarians. And here in the majoritarian system, the wishes and the needs of the minority government or minority is basically ruled out. They have been disregarded completely. And every rule, every wishes should be based on the belief of the majority community. Okay. Now let us take the case study, the power sharing in the Sri Lanka. So in the power sharing in the Sri Lanka, first of all, let us understand the demography of Sri Lanka. So first of all, in the Sri Lanka, there are two types of people. One is called Tamils. Okay. And second is called basically the Simhala. The Simhala is a language. So Simhala speaking. Okay. The Tamil speaking. Now these Tamil speakings are again two types. First, you can say the Sri Lankan. And the second is Indian. Sri Lankan means the Sri Lankan people who are native from the Sri Lanka, but they speak Tamil language. Second, the Indian Tamils. That means they have some origin from the India or they're descendant from the India and they also speak Tamil. Then Simhala means they are residing in the basically Sri Lanka, but they speak in Simhala language. These Simhala is basically having majority Buddhism. They are Buddhist, right? They follow or they profess Buddhist. So 74% of the people in the Sri Lanka basically are the Simhala speaking. They are Buddhist. And remaining around 26% of the people basically are Tamil. So you can say the Tamil speaking people basically constitute around 18% of the population, right? That 18% may be, that is basically consisting of the 18% that is maybe Hindus or Muslims, both are there, okay? Among 18%, if you want to again redivide this demography, you can say that the Sri Lankan Tamils, which were basically native of the Sri Lanka, but they speak Tamil language, they consisting of around 13% of the demography or 13% of the population. And remaining 5% are basically consisting of the Indian Tamils. So Indian Tamils are having lesser percentage, that is around 5%. 13% are still majority Sri Lankan Tamils. Right. And these Tamil speaking people constitute around 18-20% of the Sri Lankan population. Now, since its inception or since its independence in 1948, there are governments which were trying to set up the Simhala superiority in the country. So they have adopted all policies, all rules, regulations that establish the Simhala superiority in the Sri Lanka. Right. So every democratically elected government that has adopted the series of the measures, which have basically established the Simhala superiority in the Sri Lanka, right? For example, in 1956, an act was passed that basically made a Simhala as an official language in the Sri Lanka. Okay, then the government basically followed certain policies or they have made certain rules that basically, you know, favors the Sinhala speaking or Sinhala, you know, speaking population, specifically for the government jobs, for the university positions, for the university jobs. So a deliberate policy has been adopted by the Sri Lankan elected government so that the key positions in the government sector, in the university positions are filled by the Sinhala community, isn't it? And the government or elected government basically also gave the protection, right, to the Buddhism. They also fostered all sort of a protection which were given to the Buddhism, and they have adopted the Buddhism as their the main religion, right? Now, what would happen if that type of policies would be implemented in a particular state? Obviously, the Tamil speaking people, they feel cheated. So what happens is the Tamil, specifically Sri Lankan Tamil, that were basically around 13% of the population of the Sri Lanka, they felt cheated that none of the political parties, they were interested in resolving the issues that were related to the Sri Lanka Tamils. So what will happen that you know, they were basically forced to accept those policies that were basically imposed on them by the majority Sinhala community, right? So they were not given enough, you know, room for the government policies, right, in their culture, in their protection of the language, in the protection of their culture. So what happens is the root of the civil war that was started in the Sri Lanka, that was basically vested in basically this type of situation that was there, right? So the Sri Lankan Tamils basically launched a party and basically they started struggling of recognition of the Tamil as the language. They started struggling for the regional autonomy, the equality of the opportunity in every field, whether it is education field, job, or in the universities, or whatever may be the field. They started, you know, basically demanding all equality in every sphere of the life. So this has led to the civil war, and where the LTT or Liberation Tigers of Tamil was also involved, and the Sri Lankan government basically also claimed that the Indian government was also involved in basically provoking the LTT, right, specifically in the Sri Lanka, to wage a civil war. But that is not good, because the Indian government has helped the Sri Lankan government to flesh out all extremists, including the LTT, from the Sri Lankan soil. All right, next, let's understand the second case study, that is ethnic composition of the Belgium. So first of all, Belgium is a small country in the Europe, right? So it is a country in the Europe. Now, a population of the Belgium, you can understand, it is just about 1 crore. Consider the India's population around 121 crore. The Belgium population is just simple 1 crore. You can understand how the small country it is in terms of the population, in terms of the size also, definitely. So if you see, out of this 1 crore population, 59% of the population basically, you know, speak Dutch language, and they live basically in the Flemish region. So 59% is basically speak Dutch, right? Then remaining 40% basically speaks the French. That means they live in the Wallonia region. So 60% around speaks Dutch, 40% speaks French, and remaining around 1% or less than 1% speak German. So remember that Dutch speaking people around 59%, 40% speaking basically French, and 1% around basically speak German. So Dutch speakers are basically more in the Belgium. Okay, now if you see the Belgium capital, which is Brussels, right, which is also current capital of the Brussels, in the Brussels the demography is a bit different. In the Brussels, what is there, 80% of the population basically are French speaking, unlike the all country average, that is only 40% of the Belgium, 40% of the Belgium population speaks French. But in the capital, Brussels, 80% of the population is French speaking, and 20% basically Dutch speaking, and insignificant minority is also lies with the German. So in the capital, majority is 80% of the people speaks French. Now, how the power sharing model was basically imposed in the Belgium. So first of all, the Belgium leaders basically were more innovative, they are most progressive, right, in terms of the power sharing arrangements. So they have recognized, first of all, the regional differences. They have recognized the cultural diversities that were there, isn't it? So they amended their constitution almost 4 times between 1970 and 1993 in order to incorporate all such, you know, the power sharing equations, the power sharing, you know, the differences that was there in terms of the cultural, in terms of the regional sphere, right? So what they have done is, they have added the major elements in the Belgium model in the Belgium constitution. So what they have done, they have, as I told you, that at the all Belgium level, 59% people speak Dutch, 40% people speak French, and 1% people speak German. In the capital called Brussels, 80% people speaking Dutch, 80% people speaking French, and 20% people speaking Dutch. So what they have adopted, they prescribe the number of majors, because now the Dutch and French basically both were competing in the different spheres, in terms of cultural spheres, in terms of social sphere, isn't it? So what they have made in the constitution, that number of Dutch and the French speaking ministers shall be equal. So they have clearly maintained that in the central government, the number of Dutch and the French speaking ministers should be equal. So they have clearly made, that is the one progressive step they have taken. And here, no community, no single community can take decisions unilaterally, because now the Dutch and the French speaking ministers are in the equal numbers. Second, they have made a system where the state governments are not subordinate to the central government. That means the state government has the independence from the central government. Now, in the Brussels, which is a capital, have separate government, right, where the both of these community, that means the French speaking as well as the Dutch speaking, both have the equal representation in the formation of the separate government at the Brussels, which is the capital of Belgium. And they have also set up the third kind of government, that is called community government, where it is elected by the people directly, right? So the community government basically decides on the cultural, educational, and language related issues which are related with the people of different linguistic community, be it a Dutch speaking or French speaking or German speaking people. All right, let's understand the second case study, that is Lebanon. So first of all, Lebanon is basically a country. Right now, the people in the Lebanon basically having the different communities, right? They fought like hell, and they fought a bitter civil war among themselves. Okay, as a result, what happens is different community members basically died. Thousands of the people perished. They lost their livelihood, right? And what happens is at the end of the war, right? These Lebanese leaders basically they came together. And they have formed a model for the power sharing, right? It is based on the rules that they have made, the rule that they have made certain rules. For example, they have made that the president of the Lebanon would always be from the Catholic Christian. That means the president of the Lebanon would be from the Maronite sect of the Catholic Christians. They have clearly made. Second, they have made an arrangement that the prime minister of the Lebanon should be from a Sunni Muslim community. Right, that is that they have divided this power between the president and the prime minister, that president should be from Catholic Christians and prime minister would be from Sunni Muslim community. Then they said further that the deputy prime minister should be from Orthodox Christian sect, right? And the last, they have made the speaker of the legislative wing should be belongs to the Shia Muslim. So what they did is basically they have divided this power between the four constituent sections of the society. First, Catholic Christians, they made president from the Catholic Christians. Then Sunni Muslims, they made a prime minister from the Sunni Muslim community. Then the Orthodox Christian sect, the deputy prime minister should be from Orthodox Christian sect. And the last, the Shia Muslims, isn't it? So Shia Muslim should be speaker. So here, as per the sect, as per the pact, the Christians, what happens is whenever there is a fight, there was a fight, right, between the Christians and the Muslims, the Christians seek the support from the French, because in the French, the majority people basically profess the Christianity. So they speak basically or they basically take the shelter or protection from the French. And what happens is the Muslims basically always try to unify the neighboring state of Syria. They try to seek the unification with the neighboring state of Syria. They want to divide the country. So in that pact, what they have signed is that the Christians would not seek the protection from the French and the Muslims would not seek the unification with the Syria, that they have agreed in that pact. Now, there are a lot of regions for this power sharing. First of all, prudential regions. That means definitely in the terms of prudential, it will give you the better outcomes, right? It will definitely reduce the possibility of any conflict between the social groups. And it will also give you the most stable political order in the society. Then moral regions, obviously, it is obviously the very basic spirit of the democracy, isn't it? So obviously you should involve all those people which are affected by those by the exercising of that power. So once the people is getting affected, you should involve those people in the power sharing also, right? And people should have right, moral right to be consulted and have the participation in the power sharing in the government formation also. So these are the some of the moral reasons for the power sharing. Now let us understand some of the principles of the good democracy. So first of all, the democratic government is basically is the where the power is basically divided. So here the government must not be vested in a one particular person or one particular group. Rather, it should be divided. It should be by the people for the people, right? Now the people are basically ultimate source of all political power. The people are ultimate source of all political power in the country, right? So the due respect should be given to all sections of the society. Everyone should have the equal voice. Everyone should have the equal representation, and they should have, right, those sections of the society which are affected by the decisions of the particular government, right? They should have the representation of those people also. Now there are system of checks and balances which are incorporated. For example, what is checks and balances? See, checks and balances are basically, you know, checks and balances are basically those term which are basically used that different organs of the government. For example, you have organs of the government like legislature, executive and judiciary. The legislature will check the executive and the judiciary, their power. The executive will check again the powers of legislature and the judiciary, and judiciary in turn will check the power of executive and the legislature. That means every organ of the government, right, are, first of all, they are independent. Second, they should check that none of the organ of the government should overpower, should use their power in such a way that that disturb the balance of the equation, that disturb the balance of the power sharing. That means a beautiful system of check and balance is basically deduced by founding fathers of the constitution, that every organ of the government is important, equally important, and no organ should should basically exceed their jurisdiction in such a way that they try to capture or they try to overpower upon the another organ, right? For example, the judiciary should not overreach into the sphere which is given to the executive or to the legislature in such a way that executive also should not venture necessarily into the judicial domain, into the legislative domain. In the similar way, the legislature also should not execute or should not execute those policies which are restricted by the constitution and which are in the sphere of or which are required to be governed by the independence of the judiciary or to be, you know, with the sphere of the executive independence, right? All such equations are basically called the checks and the balances. Okay. So obviously the checks and the balances is basically in the horizontal distribution of the system is the most cardinal principle. Now let us understand federalism. So first of all, what is federalism? So federalism is a system of the government where the power is divided into different constituent units. The constituent units, first of all, may be your central government, that may be your federal government. Okay, at the second level you have the state government, or you can say provincial government. Okay, at the third level you have the local government, or you have the self-governing structures. Okay, so if the power is divided, that is between the different constituent units, that is basically called the federalism or federal division of powers, right? It is obviously the one of the most important cardinal principle of the vertical division of the power between the different levels of the government. You have the different levels at the central level, at the state level, at the local level, right? So federalism is one of the major form of power sharing in the modern democracy nowadays, which have adopted by almost all major democracies in the world. Okay, now let us understand some of the key features of the federalism. What are the some of the key features of the federalism? First of all, there should be always two or more levels of the government. For example, we have our constitution adopted a three-tier system, or basically we have the dual government. First of all, we have the central government, isn't it? Then we have the state governments. And now, due to the Panchayati Raj system, what we have adopted also the panchayats. So should have at least two or more levels of government, first of all. Second, the different levels of the government govern the same citizens, right? And each one have their own jurisdiction in a specific matter. For example, we will see in the next few of the couple of the slides that our constitution also provide the union list, state list and concurrent list. So we have the specific matters which are given in the union list that only the union government can legislate. In the state list, only the, and then in the normal situations, only the state government can legislate on the state list. And in the concurrent list, right, both the center and the state government can legislate, right? So there is existence and the authority of each level of the government that is constitutionally governed. So it is not the division of the power by any government, by the central government. No, it is the constitution which have governed, which have divided this power among the constituent units. That is, the constitution itself is the basis for the division of powers. Is it right? Now, and the most fundamental is that it cannot be unilaterally changed, right? It cannot be unilaterally changed. It requires the consent of the both of the central government and the state government. That is why our constitution also has that those aspects which are federal in the nature, if they are going to be amended, right, the consent from at least half of the state legislature is also must for that purpose, isn't it? So that is something which is something to be understood. Okay, now the courts are given basically the power to interpret the constitution. They interpret the constitution, they check the legality of the acts or the laws, whether it is basically confined to the power which are given by the constitution to the particular authority, or whether they basically violate any cardinal principles of the constitution. So they can declare those laws which are violative to the constitution, violative to the fundamental rights, as it null and void, isn't it? And definitely the source of revenue for each level of the government is also specified, right, by the constitution, and it basically ensures the financial autonomy to the particular level of the government, right? So the federal system has the dual objective, first of all, to safeguard and promote the unity of the country, to accommodate the regional diversity, right, which is also the most important aspect. That is why the Indian founding fathers also adapted that type of system. Now, we have also the union territories. Now, some of the territories which are called union territories. First of all, why they have called union territories? Now, they are, first of all, in terms of size, you can say that they are too small to become an independent state. First of all, their size, they are too small. Now, they are having some sort of a political importance also, right? So they could not merge with any existing states, right? Because they are too small, they are a bit different, they cannot merge. So they have formed the union territory there, which are directly governed by the central government. They are directly governed by the central government with the help of an administrator which are appointed by the president himself. So they are called the central administered territory. They are called central administered territory. For example, you have basically Chandigarh, Lakshadweep, Dadra and Nagar Haveli, Daman and Diu. They are the central administered territory which are governed by the center. Now, coalition government is basically a concept, as you have seen that in the Indian politics, the coalition of the government or coalition government is a recurring phenomena. First of all, in the coalition government, there is a government which is basically formed out of the agreement between the different coalition partners. Now, in the coalition government, first of all, there is a precondition that there should be at least two political parties. That is what that form the coalition agreement, right? So there should be at least two political parties. They are coming together and form a common minimum program, a common minimum agreement that both have shared an agreement that both will adopt the common minimum policies, right? Both will share a particular, basically policies, right? So they form a political alliance and adopted a common program for that purpose, isn't it? Right? For example, the National Democratic Alliance, which is basically, consisting of the BJP and its alliances, isn't it? Then you have UPA, that is United Progressive Alliance. The United Progressive Alliance basically consisting of the Congress plus its allies. In the similar, you have the Left Front, which is basically consisting of the left parties, which have the ideological left orientation, isn't it? Then, whether the India is a federal country? Yes, India is basically a federal country, but you must understand, the constitution basically declared that India is basically a union of states. So India is basically a union of the states consisting of the union territory as well as the states. Now, though the word federation is not used, but Indian Union is based on the principles of federation. That is, you must understand. Now, the constitution basically originally, as you know, provided a two-tier system of the government. That is, the central government at the central level and the state government basically at the state level. But now, the third-tier federation have also been set up, that you know, the third-tier basically in the form of panchayats, or that is also called the local level self-governing bodies. That is called local level self-governing bodies. These local level at the rural level, we call them panchayats. At the urban level, we call them municipalities. But they are all called the local level self-governing bodies. Now, in any federation, there are different tiers. Different tiers mean different labels, right? Which have the different set of jurisdiction. They have separate jurisdiction. For example, we have the threefold division of powers in terms of legislative powers, in terms of administrative powers, in terms of basically taxation power, right? But we don't have the division of basically your, we don't have the division of basically your, you know, your judicial power. The judicial power is not divided, right? But definitely these powers are basically divided between the constituent units. For example, the Indian constitution provides the three list. For example, in the union list, you have 97 subjects which are only legislated by the union government or by the central government. The state government cannot legislate. Then you have the state list. The state list consisting of the 66 subject which can be legislated in the normal circumstances, in the normal circumstances by the state government. But in the abnormal circumstances, the union government or the central government can also legislate on that subject. Okay, then you have the concurrent list. In the concurrent list, 47 subjects. Now you must understand initially, right? Now the concurrent subject can be legislated by the central government plus the state government. Both can legislate on the concurrent list. Now, since India is basically an example of holding together federation, what is holding together federation? That in that, what happens is the founding fathers of our constitution intentionally made the central government more powerful. They have made the central government more powerful because they want to remove the secessionistic tendencies between the constituent units. So they, in order to make the union right intact, that is the indestructible union of destructible states. So in order to make the union indestructible, the founding fathers have made the central government more powerful. But definitely certain other special status is also given to the Jammu and Kashmir, right, which is also given under Article 370, which have recently been removed by the NDA government. Now, as I told you, there are two types of federation. One is called coming together federation. What is coming together federation? The coming together federation, basically you can say that the agreement which induces the independent state to come together on their own to form a bigger unit, right? For example, initially there was 13 such states in the USA. They formed first co-federation and they came together to ultimate to form a federation. So there was an agreement. There was an agreement between the constituent units or between the independent states that they came together for the purpose of security, for the purpose of various other relationships, right? So they form ultimately the bigger unit like USA, Switzerland and Australia, right? So how did it come? They come by pooling their sovereignty. They come by basically retaining their identities, right? So that they increase their security because they were all susceptible regarding the attack from the foreign powers. So in order to secure their security, in order to give the more power, more weightage to the basically to the security, they have come together and formed the federation. The classic example is USA, Switzerland and Australia. Then the second is holding together federation. What is holding together federation? So here the large country basically divide its power, right? So definitely between the constituent units and the national government, like India, right? The India is a classic example because India is, first of all, is a large country that divides the power between the constituent units. The constituent units are basically states and the national government, right? Now, but what happens in the holding together? Holding together means the central government has made intentionally more stronger, more powerful when compared to the states and the local government, right? And what happens in the holding together federations, right? the different constituent units having the different set of unequal powers, right? They have unequal powers. One is more powerful, another is less powerful. So normally the central government is more powerful. For example, Canada, India, they are more powerful central government. Okay, some of the other examples, you can say that, you know, the India, Spain, Belgium, Canada, which have made intentionally the central government more powerful, right? So here, the sharing of the power between the union government and the state government, what we have seen here is that there is a sharing of the power between the union government and the state government. That is also the basic structure of the constitution that has been given in the Keshavananda Bharti judgment in 1973. So the Keshavananda Bharti judgment, Supreme Court of India clearly says that the sharing of the power between the union government and the state government is also the basic structure of the constitution, right? And the parliament cannot on its own can change this arrangement. It requires a special procedure, that too, right, the consent from the states, that cannot be changed. Any change, first of all, should be passed by the special majority, that is at least 2/3 of the majority that is required. And that type of federal, you know, subjects, if it is required to be amended, it is basically required to be ratified by at least 1/2 of the legislatures, that is by the simple majority. So that means if the government want to change any of the federal, you know, principle or any of the federal, you know, subject in the constitution, first of all, they have or they need basically a special majority, that is at least 2/3 of the majority that is required in every house. Second, such act, once such bill, once it passed by the both the houses with a special majority, they must be ratified by at least 1/2 of the state legislatures, right? That is by the simple majority, right? And in case of any dispute about the division of the powers, right, here the Supreme Court can make the decision based on that, because Supreme Court is ultimately the interpreter of the constitution. The Supreme Court is also considered as the guardian of the constitution, because it will jealously guard the basic principles of the constitution, that no other organ can basically, you know, take over the basic cardinal principles of our constitution. So that is the most fundamental aspects that the Supreme Court basically also called the guarantor of the fundamental rights. They are also called the defender of the fundamental rights. They are also called the guardian of the constitution in our country. Okay, now what are the different reasons for the success of the federalism in India? So first of all, there are different reasons. First of all, the constitution clearly divided the subjects into the three parts. First of all, the powers are divided into three lists. First of all, called the union list, state list, and the concurrent list, right? The union list, basically only the subjects which are legislated by the union government or the central government. In the state list, the subjects are generally legislated in the normal circumstances by the state government, but in the abnormal circumstances, the central government can also legislate on the state list. And in the concurrent list, both the central and the state government can legislate, right? Now, we have already clearly defined the nature of democratic politics in our country. We have reorganized our states based on the linguistic criteria, and for that purpose, we have also enacted the State Reorganization Act. The State Reorganization Act, 1956. And based on that, we have reorganized our states based on the linguistic criteria, right? So boundaries of several old states of the India have changed in order to accept the new equations, to carve out the new states, right? So that is basically, we adopted the linguistic based reorganization of the states, right? That is the most important aspect related to the reorganization of the states in our country, right? So we have adopted the reorganization of the states based on the linguistic criteria. Now, we have also restricted the center-state relations. How the restrictions was done based on the center-state relations? That is, we have definitely adopted, you know, the division of the power that is based on the constitution itself. Okay, so constitution basically divide this power between the center and the states. What we have adopted is language policy. First of all, I have clearly told you that the linguistic based reorganization of the state was carried out. Okay, but our constitution did not give a status of the national language to any language. We don't have the national language. First of all, There is no language which have accorded a status of the national language by the constitution. But there was reorganization of the state based on the linguistic criteria in order to unify the country, right? And made administration very easier, right? So what happens is, our founding fathers or the leaders of our country have adopted very cautiously the Hindi as a official language of the country. The Hindi is the official language, but it is not a national language. No Indian language is adopted as a national language in our country. Besides, other than Hindi, there are 21 other languages which are recognized as a scheduled language in the 8th schedule. In the 8th schedule of the constitution, which also gives certain protection in our political administrative setup by the constitution itself. Now, there are major steps which are taken toward the decentralization in 1992. First of all, the constitution mandated that there should be a regular election that should be held for the local level self-governing bodies. That is, we made the 73rd Constitutional Amendment Act, that is 1992, which provide the Panchayati Raj system. 74th Constitutional Amendment Act, 1992 again, which basically form the municipalities, that is the urban level local self-government, right? So here the seats are reserved for the scheduled caste, that is SC, for the scheduled tribe, that is ST, and other backward classes, that is OBC. Then we have also reserved 1/3 of the seats to the women, right? That is the most important step that we have taken. The State Election Commission is basically set up for the purpose of elections, that too for the panchayats and the municipal elections. The state governments basically are required to share the powers definitely with the local government bodies. So that we have taken the 11th schedule, okay, and 12th schedule, 11th schedule and the 12th schedule of the constitution, which basically the powers can be divided with the local level bodies like panchayats and the municipalities. So we have adopted the structure of the new Panchayati Raj system that we have seen. So first of all, the rural local government that we call the Panchayati Raj system, in which we have adopted the three-tier Panchayati Raj system. In the three-tier Panchayati Raj system, at the rural level, we have set up the rural panchayat. At the block level, we have set up the block panchayat or intermediate panchayat. And the district level, we have set up the district panchayat. So every village or group of village have the gram panchayat for that purpose. The panch president or sarpanch is directly elected by the people who are having the adult population, and which is also, you know, a decision making body. Now, definitely the panchayats works under the overall supervision of the Gram Sabha, right? The Gram Sabha basically consisting of all eligible voters in the panchayati area, right? So here the local structure basically goes up to the district level that I have shown you, rural level, block level and the district level. So at the rural level, you have the rural panchayat or Gram Panchayat. At the intermediate level, you have the intermediate panchayat or the block panchayat or panchayat samiti, right? Or the mandal panchayat. And the district level, you have basically the district panchayat, right? Now, all the panchayat samitis and the mandals came together to constitute a Zila Parishad, which consisting of basically your elected members, that you probably would be knowing about the Panchayati Raj system. Okay. And the Lok Sabha members, local MLAs and the officers are basically also member of the Zila Parishad. The chairperson is basically the political head of the Parishad, basically belongs to, you know, the most important figure. Now, we have also called other body called urban area local bodies. What is this urban area local bodies? So urban local bodies are basically the urban local self-governing bodies. They are called urban local self-governing bodies, which are set up first of all by 74th Constitutional Amendment Act 1992, which have set up these urban local levels of bodies. They are called generally municipalities. They are set up in the towns. Big cities are basically called set up the municipal corporations, right? So you have the municipal councils, municipalities and municipal corporations. They are known by the different names. But you must understand, both of these are controlled by the elected bodies, which are consisting of the people's representatives, right, which are again chosen as per the 74th Constitutional Amendment Act, which provide a framework for their election, which provide the framework for their, you know, for their making, specifically in the urban local bodies. And the municipal chairperson is a political head of the municipalities, and the head of the municipal corporation is also called mayor. So I hope you have seen or you have heard about this towering figure, that head of the municipalities, is basically the political head, which is also called the municipal chairperson. And the head of the municipal corporation is basically called mayor, right? So municipal corporation is basically, you know, a local level urban self-governing bodies which have been set up for the big cities. Municipalities are basically set up for the towns, right? So here the local level self-governing bodies are basically set up by two acts, that is 73rd Constitutional Amendment Act, which provides the Panchayati Raj system. Then the 74th Constitutional Amendment Act, which provide the urban level self-governing bodies, like you have the municipal councils, municipalities, the municipal corporations, which are all set up for the purpose of the local level self-governing bodies. I hope it is clear, very, very clear. Okay, so what our founding fathers have done, the founding fathers have basically reorganized the states based on the linguistic criteria. They have set up the federation, which are basically reorganized, which can be having, you know, the division of the power based on basically the three lists, that is union list, state list and the concurrent list. Okay, we have made, first of all, you know, enough independent powers given to the every level of the government. No level of the government is dependent on another level of the government, but definitely our founding fathers have made the central government intentionally more powerful in order to make the union more intact. And that is why the Indian Union is also called the indestructible union of destructible state. Why? The union is indestructible because the states does not have the power to secede away from the union, to go away from the union. They cannot become independent. They cannot move away from the union. No, the states has no power, but the central government or the parliament can unilaterally change the political boundaries of the state, the area of the state, the name of the state, isn't it? They can change. So central government can change. Central government can change the boundaries of the states, but that does not mean that the states has the power to move away from the union. No, they cannot move away from the union. So that is the reason we have called the indestructible union of destructible states. So that is, the union is intact. The union cannot be broken. The union cannot be simply broken down by moving away from the union by the states. They have no power to secede away from the union. All right. So that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next lecture. Thank you. Till then, take care of yourself, because the corona is spreading very, very fast, and it is also very, very deadly. So take care of yourself. Thank you very much.